It is not often that one gets a chance to introduce someone who you consider a hero. And I'm about to do that. And for someone who really needs no introduction in this room, but I'm going to do introduce her anyway. Dr. Mary Ruwart grew up in Detroit, Michigan, attending Michigan State University, where she earned a Bachelor of Science in Biochemistry and a Doctorate in Biophysics. She then spent 19 years in the pharmaceutical research for Upjohn Pharmaceuticals, giving her insider knowledge for the effect of governmental regulation on the drug industry. In 2008, she was drafted, essentially, to run for President of the United States as Libertarian and lost on the eighth ballot to Bob Barr, forcing me to not vote in 2008. At this time, she began working on exploring social ethics and published in 1992 the first edition of Healing Our World, which you must read, without question, revised in 2015, which contrasts the ethical ideas of libertarian principles with many of the ethically void public policies in place today, including a damning chapter on the FDA, which kills more people every year than it saves. In an effort to help libertarians communicate more effectively with those outside the party, she has also published Short Answers to Tough Questions, which is based on questions posed to her over the course of her involvement with the Advocates for Self-Government in her column, Ask Dr. Ruwart, and was also the basis for how I answered just about every freaking question when I was on the campaign trail. So without further ado, Dr. Mary Ruwart.
Here closest to me, I have Tatiana Moroz, and if you heard her last night, she's a fantastic not only speaker, but singer, and she's going to talk to us today about her exploits, and one of the things I found fascinating personally is she's the first ever artist cryptocurrency creator. Now that's pretty impressive, and I'm going to ask her also, since she is CEO of her own company, the Cyber Crypto Media Hub, to give us that website that she speaks to us. And then there's Kirsten, Tynana, and she is the head of the Fully Informed Jury Association. This organization has been around a long time. If you don't know about it, you really do. It's one of the best activist tools, in my opinion, for regaining our liberty. So I'm very excited about this panel, and as I said, I'm not going to do too much on introduction. I am just going to go ahead and ask them to come up one by one and share their stories with you. First, I'm going to ask Tatiana to come up and tell us what inspired her to do what she does, which is so unusual, and what ideas have influenced her activism, because I'd really like to hear it from somebody in the arts and find out what they do differently. So, Tatiana?
Oh, yeah, there you go. Hi everybody, my name is Tatiana Moroz, and I guess now you all know that I'm a singer-songwriter. But I always viewed music as something more powerful than just a way of entertaining people. When I was younger, my mom used to, you know, take the CD and play music in the car, and she played a lot of singer-songwriters from the 60s and the 70s, and that music is known for having a lot of activism infused, right? It brought about a big cultural shift in this country that rippled throughout the world. And I remember listening to Cat Stevens' Peace Train specifically and thinking, wow, this is amazing that not only am I enjoying this music just on a regular level, but he's also sort of getting me to think about something that I wouldn't normally think about. And it instilled in me a great value for using music for the power of good. As I got older, I started reading all the different dystopian novels, and I became terrified of the future that we actually are sort of living in right now, specifically with 1984, Brave New World, all those kinds of books. Unfortunately, I didn't really have a political leaning. I went out on a quest to educate myself. I started out with Dennis Kucinich being a really big supporter of his in 2008. I liked Ron Paul, but I didn't understand why he didn't care about the environment and you know, why he wouldn't want universal health care, because he wanted people to be healthy. And then in 2011, I found out about the Federal Reserve, which led me down a path of learning about Austrian economics, which of course was why I don't like Dennis Kucinich anymore and why I'm on Team Ron Paul. I ended up deciding that I wanted to sing to reflect this interest and this, I guess, philosophy. And I created music around the libertarian movement. I was also very inspired by Amy Allen, who had done a song that does that kind of thing. And it sort of grew from there. I've always wanted to instill in people a value for the arts, because I think it's a really important connection point. You don't necessarily have to tell somebody about the Federal Reserve, but if you can make it sort of an emotional case for them and you can relate it back to something that they care about, I think that that's really powerful. And look, I mean, some five-year-old kid listening to Cat Stevens, and now here I am talking about freedom and liberty many years later. And I think that that can have a ripple effect in our society. Great, so after I did the Ron Paul movement, I got to sing all around the country, I made a lot of really great new friends, and I got to hear a lot of different perspectives. But unfortunately, I became very disillusioned with the political process after seeing what happened with the RNC, how they were changing their rules, and I didn't really think that this was the best route to take. I still believe in the philosophy, I think that there's a lot that you can do through politics, but on a national level, I think it's very challenging. I became introduced to cryptocurrencies in 2012, but I thought it was really boring, and I wish the person would stop telling me about it. And then when the price went up, I became a lot more interested. And especially when Jeffrey Tucker took the time to, again, relate it to something a little bit more creative, make it something a little bit more, I guess tugging at the heartstrings, right? So I went to one of his events, and there I recognized something that I hadn't seen at a Liberty event in a really long time, and that was hope. And it was really, really lovely, even though I still didn't understand what the heck they were talking about. And I did understand the underpinnings and the creativity that was going into it. And I loved that it was bringing together people from different kinds of communities. So I created a Bitcoin jingle, right? And so it was just, you know, about why Bitcoin is so great. Because you want to sell something, you sell the music, in my world anyway. We went on to create the first ever artist cryptocurrency, which allows artists to fund directly from their fans, but sort of similar to current crowdfunding models, but a little bit more flexible. So you could donate to me at any time, and you could get tokens that you can give to your friends, you can sell them, you could trade them in for any prize at any point. And it also opens up a communication layer, because right now, I'm sure a lot of you have noticed that even though we all spend probably far too much time on Facebook, we're not really getting the same value out of it. It's like an echo chamber. And we're not reaching new people. With an artist coin, it allows you to communicate directly with your fans, and nobody can change the rules on you. And I think that that's really important, because if you're an artist and you are dependent on a record label, that means that they're funding your career, and that means that you have to say whatever they tell you to say, and you can't be open. And to me, that was antithetical to everything that I stood for. So after seeing myself and a bunch of other broke artists suffering, you know, I decided to create the artist's cryptocurrency, which we're going to be launching as an app probably next month. And then I created Crypto Media Hub as a solution for companies that want to get into the Bitcoin space and they want to do different kind of marketing outreach. And that was a very organic growth thing. So I'm not really sure what my message here is, but, you know, support your... Think of other ways of doing your activism than just through the political process, and support your artists and be creative, because I think that we can reach a lot of different people a lot of different ways that way.
Absolutely. So when we were conceptualizing this panel, we were trying to find cohesion and talking about being women and being leaders in the movement. I do see a theme, though, with a lot of things that Tatiana touched on, and also talking at the table with my friends here as well, that we want to reach more people as possible. And messaging is a big theme, and talking to non-traditional allies and ways of outreach and expanding our ideas further than just beyond you know, being in the political sphere, the economic sphere, the philosophical sphere, and going into creative venues. So I was my question was going to be addressing leadership skills, and especially like that have been useful in my libertarian activism. So I have a few key points with that, and then I want to drive the point home about messaging as well. So I've been involved in the liberty movement for I guess 5 years now. I got lit on fire, as a lot of young people did, by the Ron Paul and that message. And unfortunately, we're seeing that with the Bernie Sanders movement as well, and his message resonating with young people and things like that. So identifying that there are people that are characters that are principled seeming in the political arena, for some reason motivates young people. And I think it's important to not just look at their ideas and how idiotic that their economic policy might be, but try to reach them on their root causes. And that's what the Texas Millennial Institute really strives to do, is talk to people from across the political spectrum. We call ourselves a nonprofit, transpartisan organization, because our heart, at the heart of our organization, we are libertarian and we promote libertarian ideology. I'm about as radical of libertarian as they come. But we do like reaching out to people that could be socialists or Democrats or Republicans, because there are talking points that we can talk to each of these people about and expose them to libertarian ideas and bring them further into the fold. And there's a number of ways that the Texas Millennial Institute does that. We host varying events, from summits that bring out 100 people or so from across the political spectrum, to hear from speakers like Angela Keaton and scholars at the Cato Institute and Jacob Hornberger on, you know, more sensible foreign policy. And then we host events on immigration, LGBT issues, police brutality. We really try and take the temperature of young people on the ground and relate to them and expose them to a free market perspective or a freer ideology. So we'll see people on the right, they're pretty good on economics sometimes, and they need to be convinced to have better cultural understandings and being more socially acceptable. Then we see people on the left just not understanding economic issues, but wanting to alleviate oppression or you know, deal and help minority groups with different problems. So with a transpartisan approach, we're able to not be alienated by labels of political policy or political ideology, or even by age or you know, demographic constraints, and come together in like a roundtable discussion to expose each other to our standpoints and our beliefs, and then, you know, eventually talk about how do we come up with solutions that are more free market and not look to the government to solve all of our problems. Or how do we create cultural change without shoving our ideology down somebody's throat? So it's been very effective, and it expands our friend circle, which I think is something that's really important in messaging and as a leadership kind of quality.
I got involved because I wanted to find a community, and that's what a lot of young people on campus are looking for, and young people in communities are looking for. I've done things like start campus groups for years. I've started drinking chapters through Liberty on the Rocks. And what all of these people are looking for is friends to come together and maybe have a beer with and then shoot the shit and talk about ideology. So you can have friends that don't agree with you on everything and not necessarily get in contentious arguments and really come to better understandings. And when they're constantly exposed to sensible people and sensible ideas, and when you're able to identify a root cause of a problem and say, you know, institutionalized racism is at the forefront of the police brutality movement, and we don't need to look towards government solutions, we need to be trying to look to private solutions for those types of things. It really enables our message to kind of just bleed across the bounds of partisanship and expose more people to like sensible ideas. So let me see some of the other points I wanted to make sure that I touched on. Oh, I really like to surround myself with people that are like-minded, as I'm sure a lot of you guys do. And so I've looked to do that kind of in leaders that I've recruited for working with me through student groups and now through the Texas Millennial Institute, but also complement my leadership style. So I might be really great at emails, but Dustin can't write an email for his life. So we'll collaborate on things like that, and he'll go rally the troops and talk to them about data when that's the least thing, the last thing that I want to do is input an email address into a form. So as looking to be a leader and an effective leader, you need to make sure that you're listening to feedback from the people around you, both from whoever you're marketing to and kind of who your audience is, to the people internally, and that you're making sure to work together on issues. And this is kind of just something that leads through to our greater message and then our internal message as well. And empowerment is something that our organization strives for, both in our mission statement and then like at our core. We really drive that point home to not just espouse ideas, but to embody them and utilize them. It's for the betterment of our movement, for the betterment of our organization. Hypocrisy can like lead to disenfranchisement. So when we talk about spontaneous order and, you know, stigmergically coming together and coming to solutions, it's important to not institute bureaucracy into what we're doing. So at TMI, we really try and listen to people on the ground and our leaders, because I'm like a servant of the people in my organization. And we want to create change for them, not just for the purpose of creating change. So listening to feedback and taking that is really important, and that leads into empowerment. All right. Oh, absolutely, yeah. So I would love to talk to anybody about you know, what TMI does more broadly and the specifics of our events and things like that. You can visit us at Texas Millennial Institute. We're on every social media platform. We really try and embody the millennial persona for sure. And it's two L's and two N's in millennial. That's something that catches people a lot as well. So thank you guys. Yeah.
Us about some of the challenges that are faced in leadership positions, because he just certainly has its challenges.
Indeed, the first of which is getting my name right. I've seen it spelled and pronounced variously, so once and for all, it's I before R, and the first syllable of my name rhymes with beer, so it's Kirsten. So twice now since we ladies started organizing ourselves on this panel, you've heard that our time has gotten cut. I have no idea what our time allotment is anymore. So I will get through as much of my about 10 minutes of prepared comments as I can. And when I eventually get cut off by Mary having Noelle smack me in the arm, I will later on make a video covering the rest of it. It will be available on facebook.com/FijaNational. The reason I think you'll want to listen to it is because I selected things that I think will be practical items that you can use in your life, in your leadership situations. And so these are pretty common among libertarians. And the first challenge is getting libertarians to work graciously with others, in particular with non-libertarians. I always say that I work for liberty. I don't work for libertarians. They're two different things. Unfortunately, sometimes libertarians work against liberty. Fortunately, sometimes non-libertarians work for liberty. EJIA itself is not a libertarian organization, though we have our history in libertarian roots. Many of our activists and constituents are non-libertarians, and I consider that an advantage for us. Since libertarians are not going to be a majority in the foreseeable future, it is necessary to cooperate in order to mainstream our issues. And how we do that is by cooperating with non-libertarians. They're only going to want to cooperate with us if we are people of good character, if we treat each other and others outside the fold with respect. And we do not impose that attitude that we so often have of superiority over non-libertarians and treat them as less than. A second big challenge for me was driven home dramatically last summer, and that is being responsible for the safety and well-being of others. As libertarians, we're often individualists who treat each person as solely responsible for themselves, but I believe that a good leader chooses to look out for others. We have an ongoing action at the Lindsay Flanagan Courthouse in Denver, where people have been arrested, which is one potential area of unsafety that we try to address through our training and guidelines. But in that particular situation, there was another group at a different courthouse that FIJA had disassociated itself with because of their behavior. And they were very upset when the Lindsay Flanagan Courthouse made national news for its action. I was organizing a jury rights day campaign at that courthouse and made public that I was going to drive down to Denver for that. And then an individual from the group at the other courthouse began harassing me. It started with Facebook messages that were just comments on my appearance or IQ, which is fine. But then it escalated. A few days before jury rights day, I got the message from this person who was harassing me. I should ask all my group to carry guns. Might get to use them when our two groups clash. How fun, us against the homeless. 2 days before my event, he said, "We are waiting to protest you in person, fat pig. Our members carry guns. In case of any violence, we are shooting to kill. Hope it turns violent so the fun can begin." So this was an area of concern for me personally, but I was aware that very occasionally this involves threats. So I was going to go do my job. But it occurred to me that I am not the only person whose safety is at risk in that situation. So I felt that I needed to alert others who were going to be in attendance of this risk and let them decide as well. It's not just up to me and my safety. I have to look out for the safety of others. Did they feel comfortable with me still coming down? It turns out the answer was yes. It turned into a non-event, but that's not something you really know until it's over. So I think it's important to remember that we're not just each person out there for ourselves. We also, especially as leaders, need to take into consideration the impact that our choices and our actions have on other people and what their risk level and risk tolerance is. Third, I find it very difficult to convey an attitude that I wish all of us would adopt. Which is that we should strive always to turn a disadvantage into an advantage, not just to neutralize it. Neutralizing a disadvantage brings a sense of relief and getting back to the status quo. But when you turn a disadvantage into an advantage, it brings a feeling of sweet satisfaction and the notion that you've actually made progress instead of just been treading water. And two great examples of this are the Denver Courthouse, the Lindsay Flanagan Courthouse, and also the McCosta County Courthouse in Michigan, both places where prosecutors and or judges have started harassing my activists and in fact arrested them. Ultimately, when people get arrested following our guidelines, they basically are either acquitted, have the charges thrown out, or the prosecutor tucks their tail and runs. That's because they realize that they have actually just done us the biggest favor they could possibly do. There are only so many brochures we can hand out ourselves at the courthouse, but if you get us in the news, spreading my message much further than I could do myself. Thank you. That's a great Christmas present. I'll take it any day of the year. From these two different situations, we've actually had coverage not only in the local newspapers in these areas, but also in the Washington Post, the New York Times, the Denver Post, U.S. News and World Report, Reason Magazine, and a number of alternative online sources. So rather than just trying to undo the damage that's done, I suggest that we all always try to turn it into an advantage outright for ourselves.
And don't forget to tell them about our website.
Okay, so it looks like I'm not going to get done. So our website is fija.org. And then to hear my other two very insightful points that I prepared for you before our token women's panel got cut short, facebook.com/fijanational.
You actually have another minute if you want to go. I thought you were looking at me to say, oh, you were done.
Just check.
Go for it. Go for it.
A fourth thing that I always try to do is model the behavior that I'd like others to adopt. This is really something I got from Fija Vice President Robert Anthony Peters, who is such a wonderful model of gracious behavior. He's reined me in a time or two. But an example of this is last weekend I was giving a legal paper at the Academy of Criminal Justice Sciences, and we had a panel of three people. A fourth person fortunately canceled at the last moment, given what happened. The first person took his allotted time. The second person then got up and took more than twice his allotted time. And the clock was ticking. I'm the last person on the thing. I've already lost some of my time because of his not wrapping it up. The moderator isn't stopping him. And I'm about to have gone to Denver to give a talk that I'm never going to give because this other person's being allowed to take my time. Well, just for entertainment purposes, I did actually consider letting him go on and on to see if he really was just going to run me over and completely steamroll me. But then I looked out into the audience and I saw a number of young women, many of whom were probably law students, and I thought, I don't want them to take the message from this that they should sit quietly in the background. I want them to take the message from this that they need to stand up, pull someone off the stage of the message holders, and take their place at the table that they rightfully deserve. And so I got up and I told this gentleman, thank you for his remarks. We only had 15 minutes left, and I was going to exercise my right to use them for myself, upon which time he said, just two more examples, and I helped him off. He was still talking as he was being herded off. So I really want people to understand that even if you're willing to accept something for yourself that is less than what you allow others to have, you may be fine with that, but you're training others how they're going to treat people in a similar situation as you. If I had just accepted that, I would have been conveying a nonverbal message to all these women that they were not as valuable as these people speaking. So I think that covers my minute, and back to Mary. Okay.
Well, that's a great panel. You've heard from all the women about their different experiences, but there's a common thread. I hope you noticed it. And that's communication. And I'm going to continue on that thread. Because as I look around the room, I realize that we have a Ladies of Liberty leadership panel, because ladies are not necessarily represented as much as the demographics of our country would indicate. And I look around the room and I don't see many people of color either. And the reason this is such a tragedy is that liberty, if it helps anyone, helps the disadvantaged, it helps the poor, it helps the minorities, it helps women, even though women technically aren't a minority. You know, they've gone through some troubled times that may still need some work. But it's liberty that lifts them up, not statism. And we have not conveyed that message, unfortunately.
When I launched the Spassel Part 1 presidential debates and watched the candidates answer the question, do you really intend to get rid of the safe social safety nets? Not one of them mentioned that the best social safety net for the poor and the disadvantaged is less government. Fewer regulations, because each regulator puts about 150 people out of business, out of small businesses that create 80% of the jobs, mostly for the minorities and women and, you know, other people that are struggling. And we should be sharing that information. The best thing we can do for our seniors is to stop inflation. If they're living on a fixed income, inflation is cutting their check no matter where it's coming from, their pension plan, Social Security, whatever. And we don't talk about that. And we need to. And the reason we need to is that liberty, of course, is something that we can share from a reasoned perspective. But let's face it, most people come from the heart. And there's nothing wrong with that. And we've kind of denigrated that, I feel, in our rhetoric. And if you think about it for a moment, it's just the opposite of how things should go. Imagine our forefathers and foremothers sitting around a conference table trying to decide if they were going to have the American Revolution. The reasoned person would say, let's see, we're going to go up against the greatest armed power of the world. We're going to go up against the greatest naval power of the world. Of course, our credentials for doing that is we're mostly farmers. This is a dumb idea. That's what reason would say. So why did we have an American Revolution? Well, we had it because Patrick Henry, well, among others, said some passionate things. He said, give me liberty or give me death. That is a very unreasonable thing to say. That is passion. That is coming from the heart. And that's something I think we haven't appreciated as a movement. We are not just creatures of the mind, we are creatures of the heart. And the two work together. They're supposed to. So, for example, the mind is supposed to put forth the rational arguments and the heart is supposed to temper it. And vice versa. Vice versa. Sometimes the mind needs to temper the heart, they have to work together. And part of our issue, I think, is that women and some other disadvantaged people have been kind of hoodwinked by the state. We got liberty because of our passion. Give me liberty or give me death. We lost liberty for the same reason. Because in the early 20th century, what happened? The people who wanted more statism said, oh yes, freedom, liberty, it's a great thing, but you know, it doesn't help the poor. Doesn't help the disadvantaged, doesn't protect the environment. And of course, people fell for it because Americans have a big heart. They were willing to give up part of their property, part of their money, to help the environment, to help the poor. So they bought into that argument. But today, we know better. So many studies have been done about how liberty helps the poor and the disadvantaged. It's no longer a supposition, it's a fact. And we have those at our fingertips today. We need to be talking about this because, as it's been said many times, most people don't vote necessarily with their heads, they vote with their hearts. That's not necessarily a bad thing. We just need to speak their language. Another communication issue that we're bringing up here. And I think one of the problems we've had in getting women into the party is that women, in general, biologically, genetically, are geared up to come more from the heart. That doesn't mean men don't have heart. Of course they do. If you're here in the room today, you've got plenty of heart, because no one's going to come here and sit in a business meeting without a passion for liberty, right? That's just that. No one's going to go out and be an activist and spend years, as many as of us have, without having that passion. So of course you're here. You have heart. You know it. But what you might not realize is that that's your ticket when you're talking to people, when you're communicating. And if you heard these women today, you heard them talking from heart and how they consider that in their communications. Now, if that doesn't seem to resonate with you, I would just say this, just from a purely practical point. If you want to win elections, who do you want to appeal to? Well, let's see, the most prevalent sex is the female. So that's a good reason to come from heart. There are many more votes among the poor and disadvantaged than among the rich, simply because there are more poor than rich. So who do you want to appeal to? Yeah, so tell them what's in it for them. That's the biggest sales technique of all. What's in it for them? And for liberty, what's in it for them is basically, well, the sky's the limit. Because what's there for them is a better life in every single way. Now you may ask, okay, how do we go about talking from the heart? Well, I think you could probably talk to any of these women and find out. If you came to talk to me, I'd refer you to my website, ruwart.com, R-U-W-A-R-T.com. I'd encourage you to read Healing Our World and Short Answers to the Tough Questions, in which I outline how I think this could be done. It's not the only way. And some of that material is free on the website. And if Cassie is here, I don't know if she's here. She was going to sell some of the books today, if that was available. I have some in my car if you really would like to get a book and walk away with it. But you don't have to, because you know you can get some of it on the website. But I just like to end my part of this and open it up for questions by saying we really need to consider how we communicate our message. Looking around the room today, you can see what we've done. We have appealed to the people who really get the reason part. And believe me, I'm a research scientist, right? So I'm a nerd too. I get the reason part, but I also get the heart. And I think one of the things that these ladies can bring, and all the other ladies in the audience can bring, is that genetic influence that encourages us to nurture, and as part of that nurturing, encourages us to communicate just a little more from the heart. So I would just say, take it to heart that we need to bring more heart into our communications, and I think the sky will be the limit for us. Thank you. Few minutes for questions, but we do have to be out of here in 10 minutes, so we don't have long. Yes?
Kirsten!
Kirsten!
Here. There was a report that New Hampshire had done something today about the fully informed jury requirements. Were you involved with that? Did you tell us about it?
So that looks like some weird recycling of some news from a few weeks ago. The New Hampshire House passed a fully informed jury bill. Fijian National does not take any position for or against legislation. That said, check out our website in the next week or so when I have a chance to write something up about it for educational purposes only. I'm not as optimistic about it as I think most people are. A lot of times we're just excited when something, we win anything, we get very excited. But that bill actually repeals the bill that was previously passed in 2012 and replaces it with something else, so it has some issues.
I know Mary has done this, but I want to ask all four of you, are any of you planning to run for office anytime soon?
No.
I've run so many times I've lost count. I am writing another book on the FDA, so I'm doing that instead.
I know, I'm not here.
In the back, hold on.
No, I don't plan on running for office anytime soon.
I was wondering, I see Tatiana up there, and of course, in the 60s, music is what brought youth together. So I was wondering if Noelle and Tatiana could talk a little bit about how we could bring music and using emotion as well into bringing more diverse people into the Libertarian Party and the Liberty Movement altogether.
Just the only thing that I have to really say on it is, like, we've had a lot of fun around our events, like going to house shows in like Denton and showing people, like, the being friends with people and going to like music, like, things, you know. I've gone to like garage shows, like dingy bands and stuff, so before a conference or after a conference or whatever. I think anything bringing people into a community aspect is cool, and I'm a fan of the arts. I think novels are a really great way to reach people, and as my girlfriend can espouse to. But there's, you know, a lot of different artistic venues that I think will reach non-traditional allies. But Tatiana obviously is.
So my question, what is the question? How can we use the arts? Well, you know, I was hanging out with a friend of mine, right, and he was playing all this different music for me. And we were talking about how when people ask you what kind of music do you like, we said, good music. It doesn't have to be, you know, one sort of category or another. And yeah, I have my leanings toward, you know, country or folk or rock or something. But, you know, having a diverse kind of palette is really helpful. And I also think that artists naturally have that freedom desire in them, right? A lot of them are a little bit liberaled out now because they just don't know any better. But they are really good intentioned. So I think that doing that outreach and hopefully, you know, not telling them that they're wrong blatantly is a good way to kind of bring the artists into this, because they care about being free. I mean, most artists like Bernie Sanders, not because they love corporatism, but because they want, you know, more equality. So I think that those are some ways that we could, you know, spread it out a little bit.
Do you believe that the DEA is going to change the scheduling of marijuana? The reason why is because I had a friend who was a researcher, and she's retired from that, and she could get her hands on cocaine with no problems from the feds. But for her to research marijuana, she had to jump through way more hoops. Do you think marijuana eventually will be researched for the potential of therapeutic treatments and stuff?
Short answer is yes, but it may take a little while. Right now we're having all the states starting to legalize it, and that's going to drive it.
Another driver of legalization is jury nullification. Recall that during the Prohibition era, in some places, upwards of 60% of prosecutions for alcohol violations were nullified, basically making it impossible to enforce Prohibition.
Hi.
Yes, this question goes for,
this question goes for Noelle. At the Texas Millennial Institute PMI, for those who go there, what's the most important message you give to those that go there? What's the most important message that you want to spread?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Mark. Well, we really are wanting to lead people just towards a freer Texas, right, first and foremost, but ultimately a freer world. So we're trying to widely expose people to social and economic freedom, regardless of what their background is. And so by doing that and hosting events that are like around food truck freedom, or around like localized property rights cases, or, you know, just these like things that are more community driven, it gives us an opportunity to be like, hey, you wait in line for like an hour to eat at a food truck on campus. This means like you're not going to be able to like have access to affordable food, and these people are being empowered by the accessibility to be a business owner through food trucks. If you're a proponent of food truck freedom, you're a proponent of economic freedom and prosperity. So, you know, just by virtue of them contributing to you know, this like cycle of like buying from a food truck and participating in this, I mean, they're a proponent of economic freedom, and they just didn't realize it. So it's like just telling millennials what they already believe in, and framing it in like rhetoric that they can understand, which, you know, drives them to go out eventually and read one of our blogs about something more intense, or be exposed to a culturally liberal understanding when they're more conservative or something like that. So we're just trying to reach everyone at their own level, and kind of funnel them into libertarian thought through social networks. Yeah, of course.
Hi, and thank you all for being here. My name is Rhett, and some of you know I'm a candidate for President of the United States in our party. So my question for each of you, on women's rights. Why or why not hasn't that resonated here and around the world, women's rights?
Can you repeat that? I could not understand.
Yeah, I want to ask each of you the question about women's rights, equal rights for women, and why or why not hasn't that resonated around the world?
Well, I think there's a good reason, because around the world, government is even bigger than it is here, especially in the third world. And that, you know, government is the enemy of the minority disadvantaged, and in most countries, the women are disadvantaged.
I'm not really sure about the causes. I mean, people who are in power generally prefer to stay there. But I think that the solutions can really be found through, I mean, obviously I'm gonna say cryptocurrencies are very empowering. For example, a friend of mine, she has a charity called Code to Inspire, and they take donations and, you know, any kind, and they teach girls in Afghanistan how to code. And then they pay their writers with Bitcoin. So number one, they're teaching women how to code, which gives them financial independence, and it's a trait that they can, or rather a skill that they can teach to others. And when they get paid in Bitcoin, they don't need to worry that, oh, I've got money under my mattress, somebody's gonna take it from me. So if you wanna empower people, you give them the tools in order to do so, and that includes being able to survive financially.
I do think that women's rights does resonate around the world. For example, I know many Muslim feminists. I know that in Africa, many of the entrepreneurs are women. What I think does not resonate, at least for me, and probably a lot of other women, is this men are logical, women are emotional, talk to us about heart kind of thing. I have to disagree with Mary on that. My training is as a mechanical engineer. My career in engineering was as a reliability engineer. I struggle and have to learn these this alleged genetically ingrained nurturing that is supposedly attributed to me by virtue of my gender. And I think that, that kind of framing helps promote the idea that women's rights are a different thing than rights. And I disagree with that. We all just have rights. Human rights is fine with me as well.
Don't have like too much data on the issue. I know that we had a really conducive conversation around women's issues in College Station, of all places, one of the more conservative college campuses. And it's just about bringing ideas to the forefront that, you know, women want to talk about. It's allowing them to have the space to talk about what's important to them instead of, you know, necessarily tokenizing them. I mean, you know, it just is a matter of framing the argument and a lot of rhetoric. And I think once we get away from that type of lingo and when policy reflects that as well, especially, you know, in other countries and here at home, then we'll be on a better course. But I don't think it's really necessarily, you know, important to highlight gender and, you know, framing arguments and talking about policy. Women just want to be talked to like people, and I think that's a problem that a lot of politics has.
One more quick question. Is there one other last question?
Hey, thanks. My name is Nick Reed. Thank you all so much, actually. This was really enriching. A question I have, so one of the things that I think feminists get criticism from is that women empowerment can kind of be turning into that women should be just as manly as a man is in leadership. Are there any real differences in strengths that could complement?
I don't believe our strengths are inherent in us because of our gender, but because of our unique individual qualities. And I believe that everyone brings their own mix of leadership skills that work for them. That said, I don't know of any leadership skill that is unique to women or unique to men, exclusive of the other gender. I just don't see that as a gendered issue.
Yeah,
I don't like talking in terms of like a gender dichotomy either. I think that it's like disrespectful of like the you know, gender sexual minority spectrum. I think that masculinity in terms of the way that your question is framing it is problematic and can be toxic for men and women both. And I don't think that there's really, I mean, traditionally my personality traits as like a strong woman could be seen as like masculine or whatever. And that's something that we need to have a cultural shift away from in terms of looking at things like that and like looking to prop women up and telling them like, oh, good job, honey, you know, like you can stand up on stage and talk. Like, no, it's just somebody like you should be able to have the arena to just talk like a man does or like not have to worry about those types of things. So I think it's a shift away in cultural understandings and be more encompassing of a gender and sexuality spectrum. And once libertarians broadly can get to that and kind of away from more conservative rhetoric in that regard, they'll be able to appeal to people on the liberal spectrum and then pull them away from government solutions, which is really where we're waging a lot of battles.
Okay, I think we have to wrap because you guys all need to be back in the business session. But I will be around, and I think the ladies will be around for a little bit if you have other questions.
All right, thank you. We really appreciate the business session. Thank you, Mary. Appreciate it.